Okay, hello.
Hello.
Hello. It's so strange, you are very far away.
My name is
Andras Timar, and I work for collaborator activity. And today I will share my thoughts about the best practices of migration to LibreOffice and with some tips from the field, some experiences from real project, and yeah, I will show some results and the outcome case study that came out all of this. So I had a similar presentation last year, which is something is new. So who don't know about Collabora, I think my colleagues told you about this during the keynotes this morning. So it's an open source consultancy, and Collabora productivity is dedicated to enterprise LibreOffice. We call this product Collabora Office. We provide level 3 support to fix code issues. And this is why we can talk about migration. So, when we are talking about migration, obviously people want to migrate to LibreOffice in order to save money. That's the most obvious reason. But in the migration process, it's not the only thing that we have to consider. We have to consider also the staff training, because you can't believe how much it is needed in real life. So office workers usually don't know what they are doing. So training, regardless of the office product, is always very important. And when we do the migration, it's a change management issue. It's a good time to rethink some business processes around the usage of the office product. For example, if the organization uses templates or not, probably they should use templates, they should standardize on templates, or if they use, for example, Visual Basic macros, they should consider if they really need those macros or not. Of course, LibreOffice has pretty good support of Visual Basic macros, but if they don't run out of the box,
don't worry. Yeah.
Probably it's easier to reconsider the business process and not to go costly macro migration projects or development. So another common thought that comes into people's mind that LibreOffice is a free software, so they can use it free, and they want to save the 100% of the license cost of Microsoft Office, for example, and they get into the migration process, try to build their in-house competence, and probably later they fail. So Document Foundation encourages large organizations to deploy LibreOffice with the help of a support partner, of certified migration experts, certified developers, because on one hand, it ensures that the migration project can be successful. On the other hand, this financial contribution helps the office to survive, or not only survive, but improve and grow. So, I mentioned earlier that Collabora does laboratory support, which means that we are involved only in issues that have been solved on the code, source code level. So the level 1 and level 2 support, which is the basic troubleshooting or the power user level configuration issues, are done with external partners, or they are handled internally by the customer. So when a customer files a level 3 issue, first we try to reduce the problem, and depending on the service level agreement, typically within 24 hours, we give an initial reply, started to work on the issue, and we try to fix the problem in the source code as soon as possible. Of course, it depends on the complexity, and then we can build and release a binary for them in a few weeks. Compared to the upstream LibreOffice release, which can take up to 6 months to get a fix. So this is definitely a big advantage of a support contract. Some thoughts that I mentioned already in regards of migration. It needs some planning. Usually, just jumping into a change process will not lead to the desired result. In case of our largest PC, desktop PC, Collabora Office customer, Slows in Spam, Health and Social Care Trust, it took 6 months to run a pilot where they tried to find interoperability problems and tried to fix them in advance before they started to roll out the product in the company. So the original goal of this migration project, the Eastern Health and Social Care Trust, I will call them Master Hospital, because it's shorter. They haven't had a license agreement with Microsoft, but somehow the Microsoft Office wasn't part of the agreement, and it would have costed them a fortune to renew their Microsoft Office licenses. That's why they started to consider to switch to a LibreOffice-based solution. So, in total, they saved around 900,000 English pounds yearly on the 6,500 users. It's it led them to spend more. So they not only bought support by subscription to the Collabora Office product, but they also bought support. chose Colabora because it was also a UK-based company, and it has the largest group of certified LibreOffice developers, and we offered long-term support up to 3 years for the Colabora Office version. And we also offered them product management interaction, which means that if they had a need to develop new features, we were very open and actually we developed quite a few features for them, which are available, of course, for all LibreOffice users. So last year I demonstrated the SharePoint lists, the watermarks, the writers, mail merge data source, the Conneed tool, which interacts between a legacy Visual Basic application, and it translates the COM calls between the old Visual Basic application and LibreOffice. We also improved the pivot table interoperability a lot. And this year we developed a reduction feature for them and interoperable text-based form fields that I will present later. So in the migration protocol of the Document Foundation, it's highly recommended that organizations standardize on the open document format. So it would be the ideal solution, of course, because then you will rule out all of the interoperability problems, or a lot of interoperability problems with Microsoft Office, or it would be their problem, not ours. But unfortunately, it's sometimes it's just not possible. So this organization didn't want to change to open document format, and they standardized on the Microsoft formats. So it posed a lot of interoperability issues that we had to fix. On the other hand, it helped other users as well. So the outcome is positive. We have a case study which is available on request on the website. In general, we can say that although we encountered a lot of technical issues, we solved most of them successfully. So after 2 or 3 years after this project started, it is still successful cooperation. So last year fixed around 30 interoperability issues, 30 internal tickets, but I don't have time to talk about them. Basically, these were Microsoft Office documents that somehow didn't behave well in Colabora Office, and we found the root cause and fixed it in the filter core codes or in the core. But what is more interesting is the new features that we have developed for them. So let's see the first one. Well, unfortunately, it's not very well visible. I don't know how to. I don't dare to pull it further. Anyhow, the feature is called the unfold table button. So in Microsoft Word, we have this floating table concept. Floating table is a table that floating and tests can wrap around it. And it can be multiple pages long.
But the problem is that it's very easy to create a floating table in by mistake. So when you click on a table, table border, and move the mouse by 1 millimeter, it will become a floating table, and you won't even notice. On the other hand, aside from this, no? Okay, then I will speak louder. So in a writer, we don't have this. We have the floating table concept. We have text frames that can contain a table and can be wrapped around by text. But this kind of text frame cannot be extend to multiple pages. So when we import the floating table from Writer from Word, we have two options. One is to have it floating, but then it will have to fit into one page. The other option is to import it as a fixed table, and it can extend to multiple pages. But what happens when so previously it happened? It's a heuristic, basically. So we don't know in advance which one to select, because it's not always obvious when we do the layout if it will fit into one page or not. So that's why we developed this unfold table button, which is on the bottom of the table. It's a blue button. I'm very sorry, it's not visible in the presentation. But when you press it, it converts the floating table to a normal table, and then all of the content will be visible. So this is something that they wanted very much. They had tons of documents and, you know, handmade forms. So office workers who are trying to create something beautiful and quick. And, try to do the format something they can, it can lead documents that are not ideal, but these legacy documents had to be displayed properly. The other big feature that we developed for them were the interoperable text-based form controls. You know, there are two kinds of form controls. One is a text-based, which means that the form control or form field is part of the text flow. So it wraps nicely around the text. The other one is rather a shape, like a shape or a picture. So it's not part of the text flow, but the text can wrap around it and it can be resized. So you can build forms with both set of controls, of course, but in the legacy documents, mostly these text-based form controls were used. We could import and display those form controls before this development, but it was not possible to edit from the user interface, and it was not possible to change the properties. There was also some conceptual problems between the form controls in LibreOffice and Microsoft Office. So in Microsoft Office, there are two types of text-based form controls. The one is the legacy control, which was, as the name suggests, this came first. So we have this in binary doc format and also in docx, and three types of controls below there: the checkbox, the drop-down box, and the edit box. Later, Microsoft invented the content controls, which also has the checkbox, drop-down box, and edit box, but even more. The question is, how to map these to LibreOffice fields. And in the end, we chose to support the legacy controls because of the wider document format support. So we import these legacy controls and export them back to docx and the open document format. And we also implemented a new type, the date field, with a date picker. Somehow it was missing from LibreOffice and the client needed it. And in order to easily reach these new features, we have a Microsoft Office compatible form menu, new writer, which has to be switched on. The tools, options, writer, compatibility panel. After that, we have to restart the Office in order to rebuild the menu. And then we have this reorganized forms menu, which contains only those controls that are interoperable with Microsoft Word. In the LibreOffice control submenu, only those shape-like controls are included that can be exported safely to Doc and Docx. In the legacy form fields, you see the three fields that I mentioned. And in the context controls, the only context control that we actually implemented, the date in the content control. So here's the example. The text form is very, very simple. You can just enter the text. Also, the checkbox, you can check or uncheck it. For the drop down form field, the properties dialog was implemented. Then you can add, remove, organize the elements of the drop down field. And finally, the date picker content control has date picker widget, and the date format comes from the system locale. Okay, so that of course available in LibreOffice, at least in LibreOffice Master. Some parts are available in the legacy form fields are available in LibreOffice 6.3, and everything is available in LibreOffice 6.0 and 6.2, obviously, which is our desktop product. The other big feature that I want to talk about is the reduction. So I had a talk, I don't know how many of you heard it earlier today, so I will just give a shorter version of it. So reduction basically means that we remove sensitive information from the document and save resulting image of the document to a PDF that doesn't have the sensitive information. This sensitive information can be anything that you can think of, phone numbers or social security numbers or credit card numbers or whatever information has to be removed from a document. Two types of reduction was implemented. First, there was the manual reduction, which means that when we open Writer or call in this document, select from the tools menu, we select the redact option. Then, in the background, the document is converted to a meta file and opened in Grow. There, you can do the manual reduction, which basically means you can draw rectangles and hide the text or the parts of the document that you don't want to be seen. So here, this is the intermediate step when you have these gray backgrounds, so you can read, still read the text. But when you press the reductive export button on the toolbar, these rectangles will be fully opaque, and the resulting PDF will not have the information. So of course, removing text manually is a tedious process, so you can have some automation. In this case, in that automatic reduction dialog, we can have three types of targets. One is the text, the other one is the regular expression, so you can compose basically anything, and it can match to a text. And we also have predefined targets, as I mentioned, credit card numbers, or email addresses, and IP addresses. These are also regular expressions, but already made built into the product. And if you create your own targets, these can be saved to a JSON file and distributed in the organization. So, and this dialog also remembers the last targets used, so some ease of use was implemented in the workflow. Okay, so more or less that was it. And I have to emphasize that Almeria is an open source company, so everything we do, we contribute back to the whole community. So in this case, this development, we contribute everything to LibreOffice Master, so eventually all LibreOffice users will have this feature. But it's important to note that everything we do is funded by our customers. So goodbye, I would like to say many thanks to them who funded these projects, and let these great features to be made. Questions to answer, otherwise thanks for listening.